when to start. I'm okay.
Yes, sir. So I think we will start. I would like to take this opportunity to thank all the participants for joining us this morning. And today's topic is very interesting topic. As you can see, cardiac ultrasound in intensive care unit. The session speaker is Dr. Sameer Srivastava, who is Director of Non-Invasive Cardiology and Principal Coordinator of the PGDCC program at Fortis Escorts Heart Institute. And we also thought that it will be very pertinent to have a critical care specialist co-moderate along with Dr. Sameer Srivastava, especially on the question and answers. Also, given the COVID times, everybody would want to understand, you know, how the cardiac markers and imaging plays an important role in the intensive care unit as well. So for that, we have Dr. Nitin Jain with us. He is director and head of critical care at Paras Hospital, Gurgaon. Dr. Jain, apart from being an excellent clinician, is also very passionate about teaching and has been serving as faculty at various premier teaching institutions. He's especially interested in ultrasound and echo and ECMO. On that note, Dr. Jain, I hand over the baton and the stage to you.
Yeah. Good morning. Good morning, everybody. I welcome you all to this webinar. Echocardiography in ICU, as you all know, is a very, very important topic. As critical care specialists and cardiologists, we all need to know this. Although in critical care, we need to have some basic knowledge, not very high-end knowledge of echocardiography. But yes, at night when we need to do troubleshooting with our, for our patients, definitely we need to do some basics, especially the fluid management part, identification of myocardial ischemia. So I hand over to Dr. Sameer, who is the Director of Non-Invasive Cardiology at Escorts Heart Institute. Over to Dr. Sameer.
Thank you very much, Nitin. It's good of these webinars that at least you can get connected with old lost friends. So Nitin and I have been colleagues since donkey's years, and good of you to have invited him to be the chairperson or the moderator here this morning. So we are going to start with a little bit of a serious drama. This is 10 p.m. emergency room at night. 50 years old man presents with history of chest pain. Had consulted locally somewhere, and in view of his non-diagnostic ECG, was presumed to be having acute coronary syndrome. Was given aspirin, clopidogrel, loaded with statins 80 milligrams, and referred to a hospital with PCI facilities because of his ongoing pain. Now, this is not an unusual situation, and this is not an unusual scenario. Now, the time when he came to us, again, the ECG was non-diagnostic in the sense that it was showing some ST changes, but no dramatic ST elevations. He had hypertension. He was on dopamine infusion. And patient reached hospital gasping with blood pressure of 70 millimeters of mercury. Now, once you have an echo at hand, you try to do things very quickly. Unfortunately, this was not the time when we could have thrombolyzed the patient or sent. And this is what we found. Lo and behold, this is a dilated ascending aorta. And there is some suspicion of a dissection. Now, dissection of ascending aorta is so important to diagnose because it has got a huge mortality associated with this. The mortality calculated is roughly about, after the diagnosis is made, it is roughly about 1% per hour for next 48 hours. So that means if you do not do anything for ascending aorta dissection, in next 2 days, you will lose 50% of the patients. So this is a very, very big problem. And then you, even at the slightest of the suspicion, what you need to do is you have to evaluate further. We went on to do some better imaging with a four-chamber view. Again, the suspicion was stronger here, but not absolutely diagnostic. We tried to stabilize the patient and quickly got his transesophageal echo. So the suspicion started with transthoracic echo, and then quickly we managed to get his images of the transesophageal echo, and in that, the diagnosis was confirmed that this was ascending aorta. And this was the patient who was taken up for surgery. Unfortunately, he made it to life. So after this midnight or early evening drama, let me come to the presentation in particular. It was in somewhere around the middle of the 17th century that people used to look at the urine passed in a transparent flask, make some sense of it, whether by looking at the sedimentation.
Sir, your audio is not clear as of now. I'm getting a lot of messages. Can you try stopping your video, sir?
Ranjit, looks like we have lost connection with Dr. Samir.
Yeah. Right. No, there has been a connectivity issue at his end. So can you hear me?
You know, am I audible or not?
So can you stop your video? I think that will reduce the bandwidth shared.
I'm not on that video.
There is an icon on the left hand side bottom. It says start video, and you can just click on that once. Yeah, can we try now? There is quite a bit of lag.
Okay, so now restart from where I left. Lennox was the person who discovered something which was very dramatic, and it was so gross that people are still using it, if not for anything else, but as a symbol of being a doctor, and that is known as stethoscope. We have grown from there on, and we have grown in a manner that now my slides are stuck. Now we have gone into an era where echocardiography has taken over for diagnosis, and we use echo in intensive care, not only in coronary care unit, but in post-operative and medical ICUs and in emergency rooms. Actually, one of the features that we have used echo is for triaging, and echo is a good tool. Unfortunately, what had happened was that it was not till very recently that echo found its own space in diagnosis of acute coronary syndrome, because people thought that all the diagnosis and treatment could be done by ECG and cardiac markers. However, it was in 2018-19 that the European Society saw and said that no, we should include echo to at least diagnose, if nothing else, the mechanical complications of acute coronary syndrome. And that's the reason why it has found its space now. Otherwise, you'd be surprised. A cardiac evaluation by simple tests like ultrasound had no space in diagnosis of acute coronary syndrome till about 2 years back. So now we are having several techniques of echocardiography, which includes transthoracic echo, transesophageal echo. And with the same machine, with a different probe, of course, that you can look at the carotid Dopplers, you can look at the peripheral arterial Doppler and peripheral venous Dopplers, which are nothing very great in the sense that for people with they would rather be seen with peripheral venous Doppler. About not only diagnosis, but it and invaluable in ensuring optimal patient management. These are the certain diagnostic dilemmas which we find in intensive care invariably and always. And
so there is, sorry, sir, I'm bothering you again. There is a lot of disturbance. I'm getting a lot of messages. Can we relook at the, is there a possibility you could connect through a headphone or something? Because there is a crackling.
Audio is not audible?
Sorry, sir?
Audio is not audible?
So there is a crackling sound. Is there a fan playing?
No.
Yeah, because I think everybody, can I just get a quick response from everyone?
Yeah, I'll shift my position.
Possibly. There is a constant crackling sound. Somebody just suggested if you can change the laptop position. Voices, yeah, you can see the chat box, you know, there are a lot of there's a lot of feedback.
I'm okay now.
This is better. Yes, sir.
Better.
Yeah. Can you actually
we will continue with diagnostic dilemmas in intensive care. And these are because of unexplained hypotension, unexplained breathlessness, unexplained fever, chest pain evaluation is a must, stroke, limb ischemia, and DVT. And these are the situations in which what we need to do is to find out whether there is a hypovolemia for unexplained hypotension, LV dysfunction, mechanical complications of MI, valvular dysfunction, cardiac tamponade, pulmonary embolism. For unexplained fever, the ones which can be labeled into the heart would be infective endocarditis or acute pericarditis. For stroke and limb ischemia and DVT, especially in people who are immobilized with concurrent illness, you can find an intracardiac clot, carotid or plaque in the bifurcation of the carotid arteries, vegetations and intra-aortic balloon pump. These are the things which we have seen in past giving us trouble. Now, echo the troubleshooter. Again, I'll pick up a few examples to prove my point. 60 years old gentleman suffered an extensive anterior wall MI, was admitted to ICU, thrombolyzed with streptokinase and stabilized. Shifted to us on day 3, he suddenly deteriorates and goes into pulmonary edema, which is resistant to treatment. Now, what are the likely causes? Usually and invariably, it is either reinfarction or acute mitral regurgitation or ventricular septal defect. Unfortunately, what happens is that clinical examination A is diagnostically a little difficult because systolic murmurs can occur without any specific cause and you can't really pinpoint what's happening. So this is what the echo showed. Lo and behold, this is a paracentral long axis view where if you look, this is the LA, this is the LV, this is the aorta. This is the interventricular septum and there is a huge big rent which is flowing from below upwards. So this is nothing but a ventricular septal rupture. Now these are very dramatic cases where if you intervene early and you can really save lives. Yet another example to prove my point, a stable post-operative anterior wall infarction patient who was recovering well. So see what is the MI. MI is anterior wall myocardial infarction. And he was recovering well and suddenly he develops low blood pressure, had a cardiac arrest and could not be revived. We just had enough and more time to do his echo. Again, the fight was whether it was reinfarction, acute MR, ventricular septal rupture or a cardiac rupture. This is what we found. So mind you, this is a paracentral view where there is an LA, this is mitral, here there is LV, aorta, and aortic valve and aorta. But where is the rupture? Rupture is in the so-called inferolateral, the now inferolateral or earlier posterior wall. And what was the MI of that this man? He had an anterior wall myocardial infarction. So if you look at it, it is probably a type 3 LAD which is turning all the way around the apex and at the junction of the infarct and the normal tissue, that is the place where there is maximum shearing forces. And this is the place where the myocardium gives way and leads to a free wall rupture. So these are very dramatic cases. In this case, we couldn't help the man, but at least we sent him to his maker with a diagnosis and a label, which we knew was something in which science could not help. Couldn't help much. Now, this is yet another example, 60 years old man. Chronic smoker was a known case of COAD presented with sudden onset of breathlessness. Examination revealed bilateral extensive ronchi. Now, the conventional teaching is ronchi means worsening of bronchial asthma. Krebs means left ventricular failure or interstitial lung disease, depending upon what type of Krebs you hear. But it couldn't be further than from the truth than this statement. Why? Because once you see these people, you keep treating them for exacerbation of bronchial asthma, or the dump diagnosis, as I call it, of the COPD or COAD, and you many a times miss acute mitral regurgitation or LV dysfunction. So this is an LV dysfunction with a mitral regurgitation, which is a big time mitral regurgitation. Whether you can help these patients or you don't help these patients, but at least the therapeutic options get differentiated, and rather than giving nebulizations or bronchodilators, you start pushing more of ACE inhibitors and diuretics, and at optimal time you start adding beta blockers, or these days the new toys for the boys is ARNI. Then there is yet another big time problem, which is unexplained ICU hypotension. Many a times etiology is often difficult, and there is a very interesting study, though the design of this study was something which went into a big time criticism. But since the conclusion of this study suits my convenience as an echocardiographer, I'm quoting it, and it's from a very well reputed journal called NEJM. And they said that when you do a hemodynamic monitoring with PA catheter, it is associated with several problems. Hemodynamic data is often not true representative, associated with significant morbidity and mortality, and there is no structural information, and all these things can be debated in favor of an echocardiography. Though the subset of patients where the PA catheters was put was such a sick subset that they had to die in any case. But the blame went on to PA catheter, and this was the conclusion by the authors, which was very heavily debated in subsequent issues of NEJM. Now, what all hemodynamic information we can draw from echo? We can find out the volume status, cardiac filling, intracardiac pressures, systolic and diastolic functions, valve structures and functions. I have shown you examples of complications of myocardial infarction in form of ventricular septal rupture, acute mitral regurgitation, aneurysm and cardiac rupture. All these things can be very easily picked up, and so difficult to pick up by any other modality. Pericardial disease, etc. These are the things which we can get echo to help us formulate our therapeutic options. So echo can identify cause of hypotension in most of the cases with extremely low risk of complication. This is the thing which Dr. Nitin Jain was highlighting, that if we have to find out the volume status, what is the best way? So this is right ventricular size and systolic function is one. And second is looking at the inferior vena cava. I have a rule of 5 and 25, though there is a very good algorithm. But when you are in intensive care, you don't really remember it is 2.1 or 2 or what, but you can remember things which are by and large, which go into their head. If all you have to do is go into the subcostal, look at the IVC size, and look at the respiratory variation and the contractility. In a normal pattern, if your IVC diameter is 5 millimeters and the inspiratory collapse is greater than 50%, rest assured, patient can take big time volumes because the RA pressures are less than 5. This is one extreme. Another extreme is you go into the subcostal, look at the IVC size. If your IV size is huge, so cutoff is 2.1, and for sake of remembrances, remember this is my rule of 5 and 25. If your IVC diameter is greater than 25, with no or less than 25% changes during respiration, you are looking at an RA pressure of 25 millimeters of mercury. So if 5 millimeters of size, less than 50%, more than 50% collapse during inspiration, your RA pressures are 5 or lesser. if your IVC diameter is 25, if there is less than 25% changes in inspiration, your RA pressures are greater than 25. This is the person who would do better with inotropes rather than push-in fluids. You push in fluids and you are going to precipitate failure. Now, not only that, you can estimate stroke volume, you can estimate cardiac output, you can have intracardiac pressures, you can have estimation of preload, afterload, and contractility. Those are all things which are based on something known as a modified Bernoulli's formula. And in this modified Bernoulli's formula, the difference between the two chambers is calculated by the velocity in between the two chambers, which is 4V square. So to give an example of this, delta P means upstream pressure minus the downstream pressure. So if you have to have a pressure difference between LV and aorta, so what we are doing is we are taking the pressures across the aortic valve, and this is how it is calculated. So once you have a velocity across the valve, let's say if this velocity is 4 meters per second. So apply your Bernoulli's formula, and this formula will give you 4 into V square is 4. So it will be 4 into 4 into 4, which is 64 millimeters of mercury. So if your LV systolic pressure is 184, this means that your blood pressure should be 120. So if you know your blood pressure, you can calculate the LV pressures like this. Now, there is something known as a diastolic dysfunction and diastolic parameters, and which can be seen very quickly, very easily by mitral inflow patterns. All you have to do is put in a Doppler across the mitral in between the tips of the two anterior mitral leaflet and posterior mitral leaflet, and look at, you would be, I don't want this kind of a pattern, because this kind of a pattern is associated with very poor prognosis, and these are patients who die rather quickly. This is known as a restrictive pattern. All you have to see is the A wave and the E wave. If the E wave is tall, sharp, rapid decline, A wave is short, these are people with high mortality. And once you see a pattern of this sort, then rest assured your left ventricular end diastolic pressure is greater than 25 millimeters of mercury, which is almost being in pulmonary edema if it is of acute onset. Now, till this time is fine, but this is bad prognostic. Not only that, if people are accustomed to doing echoes comfortably and conveniently, you can look at the pulmonary vein flow pattern. And if this was to be the A wave duration in mitral inflow, and this was to be the A wave in pulmonary vein flow, the best parameter is to take this ratio duration. And if A wave duration is less than P wave A duration, so this is A wave duration from here to here, this is P wave, pulmonary vein duration from here to here. If the duration is greater than 50 milliseconds, then left ventricular end diastolic pressure is greater than 20. But I will not suggest that people who are into early initiates of echocardiography should attempt to do all these things, because it's difficult to for an initiate to look at the pulmonary veins by transthoracic echo. Transesophageal echo is very beautiful for seeing the pulmonary veins, but sometimes it can be a challenging thing for people who are in intensive care, especially when the panic strikes. Then you can calculate your preload by calculation of RA pressures. RA pressures are best calculated by IVC. Similarly, you can calculate RV, LA, LV dimensions can be seen. RA pressures can be seen. Pulmonary capillary wedge pressures can be seen. LVDP can be calculated. So people, if you have to buy a new machine, I would suggest buy a machine where there is a tissue Doppler also, because the best way to calculate left ventricular end diastolic pressure with very great ease is to calculate the E wave of the mitral and calculate the E prime of the myocardial tissue at lateral or medial borders and take an average of that and take a ratio of E to E prime, which will give you a fairly good idea as to what the LV filling pressures are. Mitral inflow, we have talked about pulmonary flow inflow. We have talked about afterload. We can calculate by calculating the SPR, mean arterial blood pressure minus the RA pressures, which can be calculated by IVC size. Divide them by our cardiac outputs. You can calculate systemic vascular resistance. Contractility is something which is left ventricle ejection fraction and fractional shorting. Ejection fraction is something which is an obsession with all of us. It has its own relevance. I'm not denying that, but we are more obsessed than what its real effective value is. So for unexplained hypotension, let me just show you our own experience of, this was long time, some 20 years back we did it. This was for post-operative bypass graft surgery, recovering from ICU. And they became hypotensive without clearly identifiable cause. They all underwent transesophageal echo. And this is what we found. Out of the several, 8 were hypovolemic and they had underfilled cardiac chambers with normal CV. A transthoracic is a challenging thing to do in a post-operative phase of whether it is bypass or valve surgery. Because of bandages, you can't make the patient turn to the left. You don't get very good windows. There are tubes. It's very bright light in the recovery room. So best is, in case there is any suspicion, you can't get a reasonably good window, go ahead with transesophageal echo and you'll get the correct answer. So this is 8 patients who had hypovolemia, 65 patients had pericardial collection, 18 had with tamponade, 14 without obvious tamponade, but they all recovered because once you tackle that, this is a very simple thing. You re-explore the patient, take out the clots, and you'd be fine. 30 patients had ECG changes. So they underwent re-exploration and graft revisions. 24 had normal transesophageal echo and responded to optimization of drug therapy. There were a subset of patients where the normal TE responded to optimization of just inotropes and vasodilators. So this is a typical example of what you discover several times. If you look at this, this is a transesophageal echo, and most dramatic is the chinked RV. This is, you have to look at the hooves of the horses. Pericardial effusion postoperatively is not black like the way we see it in routine pericardial effusions like tubercular or hypothyroid or post-malignancy. It is collection of clot, and this clot has a consistency which is not as black as the center of the cavity of the RV or LV, and that's the reason it's so easy to miss it. And they are most of the times at very atypical locations, and that's the reason you have to have a high index of suspicion. And how do you evolve your high index of suspicion? You evolve your high index of suspicion by looking at the indentation of the LV, RV, RA, LA cavities. Here we find that the RV cavity is chinked and this is being compressed by a collection. Again, if you look at this, this is the same patient with RV being almost chinked here, but you can see that the RA is dilated. This is all because of the back pressure changes. So echo is more than what the eye needs. And I'll go on to give you more examples. So here is a patient who underwent permanent pacemaker insertion for symptomatic complete heart block 2 months before we did this examination. He developed high-grade fever and septicemia. After ruling out usual causes of fever and despite extensive investigations, no obvious focus of infection could be ascertained till echo was done. So the reluctance is because for infective endocarditis, there are certain low-risk cardiac disorders. Atrial septal defect. It is assumed that patients with atrial septal defect will never have vegetations or endocarditis. Similarly, post-permanent pacemaker implantation, it is supposed to be a low risk, where the risk of vegetation is so little. But lo and behold, this is what we find. Here is the end on your lead, which you can see, And over the lead somewhere, you see a huge big chunk of mass, which is popping in and out of RA through the tricuspid valve and going almost till the end of, RV entrance. Now, what is the diagnosis? This is nothing but an endocarditis of the lead. So these are things which come as a surprise. And once they come as a surprise, you become more focused to do more and more of echo in patients with anything unexplained. Yet another example, patient underwent an AVR, recovering well after AVR with myomectomy. So there are several patients with aortic stenosis who will have both procedures done. One is aortic valve replacement, and because there is a septal or a basal septal bulge, they would need it. Otherwise, you replace the valve, and these people start behaving like a hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. So this is the reason why it's many a patients with AVR will have to undergo myomectomy. He developed high grade fever on the 18th postoperative day. Blood culture, urine culture, all negative. Chest rays, X-rays, all negative. What is the cause? So on transthoracic, we did have some suspicion, but this is what it showed in transesophageal. And when you see this transesophageal, here is a huge big chunk of muck. And this huge big chunk of muck is nothing but, and you can see posterior shadowing because of an artificial valve here. And if you look at this, this is nothing but aortic root abscess. Aortic root abscess is an emergency situation in the sense that you have to put the patient on surgery again, because early prosthetic valve endocarditis, even if there is no aortic root abscess, is something which behaves very ominously, because invariably and always it is because of staph. And staph is a very unforgiving bacteria. It may be more forgiving than corona, but staph is notorious for being unforgiving. So this is the numbers for infective endocarditis. Transesophageal echo can detect vegetation more than 2 millimeters with a sensitivity of almost always 90 to 100% in case of native valve endocarditis. However, the sensitivity falls some bit in a prosthetic valve endocarditis, expectedly so, because of the posterior shadowing, you might miss a few vegetation. But the bottom line is that it has got a very good pickup rate, for especially if the vegetation is larger than 2 millimeters. And specificity is almost 95% or thereabout, which makes it a very, very useful tool for diagnosis of endocarditis. And fortunately, it has been now recommended as one of the major criteria for diagnosis of endocarditis. So look at the versatility of this mode. 23-year-old lady with severe mitral stenosis was admitted with atrial fibrillation, with fast ventricular rate, with sudden onset of left side hemiparesis and altered sensorium. So there is no rocket science in that. We know it's a cardiac embolic phenomena. Transthoracic echo could not reveal anything for whatever reasons. I'm sure that the people would have not hunted for it. Otherwise, there was no reason why somebody would have missed such a huge big clot. And this is something which is concerning, because once you have a clot of this sort, you know the cause and effect. Not only that, if you can look at this, there is some swirling and whirling, and it's smoke-like thing, which is an associated thing called the spontaneous echo contrast. Now, spontaneous echo contrast, once you start seeing, you should desperately try to hunt for a clot, because spontaneous echo contrast are the precursors for development of clot. And once you see them, there is a good about a third. This is a LA thrombus on T in the LA clot. Now, this is yet another example. 40 years old gentleman recovering following bypass, suddenly developed breathlessness. Chest X-ray ECG was almost normal. On transthoracic echo, there was no evidence of worsening of LV function or pericardial effusion. However, it showed mild generalized hypokinesia of RV. And what did the echo reveal? This is what the echo revealed. keep looking at this here. I know there is a lag between what I'm showing and what you can see. So at some point, I'm going to repeat this clip again so that everybody sees that this is a short axis across the aortic valve highlighting the pulmonary artery. And at the bifurcation, you can see there is a huge big chunk of clot, which you can see. Now, this is nothing but a pulmonary embolism. And here, the versatility again comes, because I'll go back to the slide earlier. And if you look at this, there is a lower limb venous Doppler, which later showed that there was a DVT on the right side. So this is something which is very dramatic, and these can be sorted out very well, because you leave them and you are looking at a very high mortality. You treat them and you have a chance that you can prevent the man to meet his maker. Now, how do you pick up? There are several features that which the initiates must understand, that how do you pick up pulmonary embolism. ECG is non-specific. X-rays are non-specific. CT scan at times to shift the patient. So how do you make a suspicion? The way you make the suspicion is by looking at the short axis, and if you find that the interventricular septum is flattened, this is known as a D-shaped curve. And this D-shaped LV is the thing which gives you a highlight that, look, I'm looking at a high RA pressures and high LV pressures. And high LV pressures means that what you are trying to see is a pulmonary embolism. So if you find that the RARV are dilated, this is RARV which are dilated. If there is a D-shaped curve, LV, and if the PA pressures are high, start hunting for acute pulmonary embolism. Start hunting for acute pulmonary embolism. So this is for acute pulmonary embolism, a little bit of a background, that ECG, chest X-ray, and arterial blood gases are often misleading. Lung scan, CT chest may not be possible in a very dyspneic patient. Echo is easily available, can be performed bedside, can reliably exclude hemodynamically significant PE, answers the most crucial question, whether to thrombolyze or not. Lower limb vascular ultrasound, same machine, different probe, reasonably sensitive and specific for detecting deep vein thrombosis, provides extremely valuable corroborative evidence for acute pulmonary embolism. And this is the advantage of echo. So can echo serve as an astrologer? Can predict future? So there are certain prognosticating numbers that if you look at it, it can prognosticate with some certainty, if not reasonable certainty. And these are ejection fraction. Though I have my own thoughts on ejection fraction, but it is one of the important determinants of future complications. If the ejection fraction is less than 40%, it is associated with bad prognosis. So this is a study which was very old study, and the comparison it did was with regional ECG, where the pickup rate with ECG was 40% and the prognostication sensitivity was 91% with ejection fraction. Then there is something known as a wall motion score index. It is calculated on the basis of wall motion pattern for all the 16 segments. Now, if you go by the current American Society of Echocardiography recommendations, instead of 16, they have had 17 segments. And these 17 segments, the 17th segment is the apex. Why they had to do it was because echocardiographers are very mild and very, docile kind of practitioners. Whereas CT scanners, MRI people, nuclear scanners, they are one of the more robust ones. And they have 17 segments, and for comparison's sake, so that everybody is talking the same thing as far as wall motion is concerned or the segments is concerned. So unanimously for all imaging now, 17 segments have been including, and the 17th segment being the apex. So wall motion score index, in case it is 1.7 or greater, it means there is a 20% or greater perfusion defect then you calculate it by the myocardial perfusion imaging. Now, these are certain things which I have mentioned, that if you have a restrictive pattern, what was the restrictive pattern? Tall E, short deceleration time, small a. And if it is a restrictive pattern, then there is an increased risk of CHF and mortality. So deceleration time of 130 milliseconds indicates a future development of CHF. And there's something known as an end systolic volume. If your ends larger the end systolic volume, then there is a it predicts increased risk of future complications, especially CHF. So now where are we as far as so much of jargon is concerned? So people have said that in general, people who are working in intensive care, they need few basic things. And this is, some people call it FADE, some people call it FOCUS, some people call it POCUS. So this FOCUS cardiac ultrasound is refers to the use of ultrasound to evaluate cardiac pathophysiology at the point of care by providers actively managing a patient. So FOCUS is used in intensive care and emergency department to evaluate patients in shock with shortness of breath and chest pain. There is yet another nomenclature for almost the same thing. So whether you call these are all synonyms for the same kind of a concept. Focus assisted transthoracic echo or FATE is a type of transthoracic echocardiogram or sonogram of the heart, often performed by non-cardiologists. And the protocol has been used in existence since 1989 and has four projections: subcostal four chamber, a apical four chamber, peristernal long axis, and peristernal short axis. And these are the FATE views. Simple four views. And these four views, if you do, there is a greater than 90% chance that you are not going to miss anything disastrous. Finer things, leave it to people who claim themselves to be echocardiographers, but you should not be doing lesser than these four in your intensive care. There is a subcostal four chamber. Simple, if you have your probe, this probe has got a pointer. This pointer should be pointed from the subcostal area and pointing to the left of the patient. That means your right and patient's left. And you should be able to see a picture of this sort where there is LA, LV, RA, and RV and some pulmonary veins. But if this is the picture which you get, you are in good shape that you have managed to get this. Then go slide your transducer upwards, go to the apex, keep it there. And with your pointer towards the left shoulder, this of the patient. This is to your right and patient's left back. If it is there, you should get this four chamber view, which is the bread and butter view, as I call it, because you are able to see two major valves, mitral and the tricuspid valve. Then you have to learn to, this is a little tricky, get the patient into the left lateral position. And now the transducer has to be such that the pointer faces the right shoulder of the patient. Your left and patient's right shoulder in left axis. And this is what the view should be. You should be able to see LA, mitral, LV, aortic valve, aorta, and some bit of the right ventricular outflow tract. And this should be the picture which you should get in peristernal long axis. Keep the transducer there and twist it by 90 degrees. And this is peristernal view at the papillary muscle level. Keep fanning it down towards the apex. You start getting short axis at different levels till the apex. Keep fanning it up towards the base and you start seeing the aorta and the pulmonary artery. So these are basic FATE views which everybody should be accomplished, and try doing it in a stable patient rather than when the need is there in intensive care. And that's the time, if you're not used to getting these views, you'll start fumbling and start making some disastrous diagnostic blunders. So can we get away with all this? This is all monitoring equipment. Yes, we can, but mind you, echocardiography is an invaluable and essential modality for diagnosis, evaluation, and prognostication in ICU. The ability to provide information about both anatomy and physiology with ease of operability, non-invasive nature, and portability are features beyond comparison. Let me tell you one thing. Don't please go back home thinking that in an intensive care, you can make all the diagnosis by echo. But it is good to have this tool because you can suppose, but find it out. So this was Mark Twain's statement. He says, supposing is good, but finding out is better. But don't be entirely dependent on only echo. Because if you do it, you can miss problems with lungs, you can miss pneumothorax, you can miss several things. Because if you have a tubular vision, don't be guided, because in a tubular vision, you'll see only what you want to see. And in the bargain, several times, you can miss a beast. Thank you very much for a patient listening. And are you there?
Hi, sir. Yes, thank you so much. It was a wonderful presentation. May I now request the participants to start posting questions, and I would also like to welcome Dr. Nitin to take up the question and answer.
Any questions from the audience?
So, can you see the chat box?
Yes. So, the first question is from Rahul. How can we measure the LV and diastolic pressure, and if we don't have TDI on echo, and how to measure PCWP and right ventricular end diastolic pressure as well?
Okay, so let me just tell you what is the back pressure equivalence, as I understand. Left ventricular end diastolic pressure, when the mitral is open, is same as LA mean. 2/3 of the time in a cardiac cycle, it is diastole. In diastole, the mitral valve is open. So LA pressures and LV end diastolic pressures are same. This LV end diastolic pressure is same as pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. And this pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is same as that of RV. So we are looking at back to back. But the best way to calculate left ventricular end diastolic pressure is by a tissue Doppler. If not, then you can make some assumptions depending upon what the anatomy is. Say if a person has got an ejection fraction of 25%, 30%, 35%, you know that LVDP is high. Then you can look at only the mitral inflow and make some assumptions. If it's a restrictive pattern where there is a tall E, short A, short deceleration time, you know that you are looking at LVDP, which is high. Similarly, you can look at the P wave width of pulmonary vein A wave width and versus the A wave width of the inflow you can make. So there are several ways to do it. But if you want to really have a number which you can give it, you must have a tissue Doppler to find out E to E prime. That is one of the better ways, though it has its own fallacies too.
Okay.
Sorry, RA pressures you wanted, Nitin? He also wanted RA pressures?
RA pressure as well, sir.
So RA pressures is easy, you know, because RA is connected to what? Where does the RA derive its own blood? It derives its blood from SVC and IVC. So if you can calculate IVC size and contractility, you are pretty much sure that it is RA pressures which can take the filling or they can't take the filling. So I gave you a rule of 5 and 25. If your IVC diameter is 5 and the contractility is more than 50% with inspiration, your RA pressures are about 5 millimeters of mercury and the patient can take good volume. However, if the size is greater than 25, and the contractility during inspiration is less than 25, you are looking at RVDP of 25 or greater, which is a bad prognostic sign. Not only that, the patient can go into failure if you give more of fluid.
So second question is from Ravi. He asks, what are the IVC collapse values for a 10-year-old child?
When it comes to children, they have their own Z scores. And these Z scores are something which you should have in your own pediatric intensive cares. But if you don't know the values, doesn't matter. A contractility is good enough. For contractility, the percentage is almost the same for children, neonates, or for adults. But as far as numbers is concerned, you'll have to look at the Z scores and see what is the Z score for that height and weight of that kid.
So the next question is, when the patient is on ventilator, is the IVC diameter reliable?
And no, sir.
How to decide on the RA pressure?
So what is to be done is when there is a ventilated patient is you can transiently stop the ventilation and look at the IVC collapsibility and the size. If not that, then you'll have to, you have most of the times IVC, the filling pressures in a ventilated patients are easy because most of the times they would have some kind of a pressure monitoring catheter like Swan-Ganz.
Yeah,
use that. But I agree with you that in a ventilated patient, it's very fallacious, and there are certain numbers in formula, but unfortunately none of them has been validated. That's the reason I'm not highlighting that. But if you can transiently stop it, you can see it. Otherwise, don't hesitate, shove in a Swan-Ganz.
Yeah, so we also follow the same method that usually we try to put our patients on CPAP. So if the patient is able to tolerate a CPAP, then we try to measure the IVC diameters. If we are not able to do that, sometimes we try to calculate the IVC distensibility index. But again, as Dr. Samir said, not very reliable. Okay, so next question is from Ramya. Can you explain how to calculate the EF?
Oh my God. So EF is basically end diastolic volume minus end systolic volume divided by end diastolic volume multiplied by 100. Ramya, I'll just give you one example to tell you that what does ejection fraction mean and what are the fallacies. So if there is a LV diastolic volume of 100 cc and it ejects out 20 cc, what is the ejection fraction? Ejection fraction is 20%. And what is the cardiac output? Cardiac output is 20 cc. Now for some reason, you reduce your end diastolic volume, the LV volumes. You reduce them by giving diuretic, you do give them ACE inhibitors, or you do something very stupid like do a Batista surgery. Batista was a surgeon, Brazilian surgeon, very interesting man. What he used to do was he used to take the patient to the OPD, the OT. In between the two papillary muscles, he would take out a chunk of LV, take it off and throw it in the dustbin and stitch the two ends together and would claim that the ejection fraction improved. Did it? We did 4 patients with Batista surgery. In everybody, the ejection fraction improved. Ejection fraction improved because the LV volume reduced. So now I'll come back to the mathematical model. 100 cc of blood is coming into LV. 20 cc get ejected out. So ejection fraction is 20%. Cardiac output is 20%. You reduce the size by diuretic, ACE inhibitors, or Batista surgery to 50 cc, 50. This volume contracts, and now how much is the ejection ejected blood? Say if it is 15%, 15. So this 15% out of 50 cc, ejection fraction is 30%, but cardiac output has fallen. So this is what is the problem with ejection fraction. You calculate ejection fraction, it is so volume dependent that it has a lot of fallacies. But how you calculate is, there are several things. Simpson's rule is there. There is, all you have to do is go into your four chamber, outline your LV in diastole, outline your LV in systole, go into two chamber, outline your LV in diastole, outline your LV in systole, calculated. This is the most conventional, well-established method. But fast growing is calculation of ejection fraction and volumes by 3D. If you have 3D, then it gets automatically calculated. You have to do a fairly little bit of adjustments here and there. But over a period of time, the way in which we would be able to give some kind of a credibility to echo calculation of ejection fraction volumes and volumes is by 3D. Otherwise, the MRI people have started claiming the roost.
Okay. Next question is from Dr. Rakesh. He asks, so kindly explain the diastolic dysfunction, irregular heartbeat or tachycardia.
So these are certain Achilles heels. Achilles heel for any imaging person or anybody who's in hemodynamic calculation, atrial fibrillation is the Achilles heel. Now, how do you do it? Because your E to A ratios are lost because your A is lost. The moment you lose your A, how are you going to calculate? So what you have to do is you have to be entirely dependent on things like deceleration time and IVRT. So isovolumic relaxation time and deceleration time are the things which make you dependent. And that also, mind you, don't be reliable on only one beat. If you have to be dependent on multiple, say 10 beats, take an averaging, and then you can make some sense of it. But it is appropriate that you don't calculate diastolic dysfunction in such patients, because this is quite an Achilles heel. These are certain special circumstances in which diastolic dysfunction has been very poorly studied, actually. But there are ways. You can calculate velocity propagation, but again, you have to average it over a period of 10 beats or something, that you can get some sense of it.
So, sir, next, there's just a comment from Dr. Muralidhar. He says ultrasound is now being used to look at the lungs too, and presence of B lines more than 3 indicates pulmonary congestion. Yes, he's absolutely right.
Correct.
Whenever we are doing ultrasounds in critical care, we try to look at both the things, echo as well as the lung windows, which helps us to decide the cause of breathlessness, fluid status, a lot of information we can get from the ultrasounds. So
it's
next
something
question.
Like a sand beach appearance, if you get, then you're looking at things which...
Yeah. Correct. Even we can identify pneumothorax on the bedside with the ultrasound. So next question is from Dr. Bhushan, who's asked how to differentiate between large pleural effusion and small pericardial effusion in ICU setup, especially when the patient is unconscious.
So go into peristyle view. If you are going into the peristyle view, look at the effusion. If the effusion is behind LA or behind the descending thoracic aorta, you are looking at a left-sided pleural effusion. However, if it is more towards the LV side, then you are looking at a pericardial effusion. This is actually, by looking at tamponade, you are not really sure, because large pericardial effusion or large pleural effusion, both can give rise to tamponade. But if you are looking at only pericardial effusion, then you have to have a rim of fluid along the LV beyond LA. Reason being that pericardium has no reflection behind LA. So this is with a caveat, because many a times if it's a very large, very huge pericardial effusion, this pericardial effusion which is there behind the LV or the RA can reflect back and come behind LA. But per se, behind LA, there is very minimum of pericardial effusion. So if you are seeing pericardial effusion selectively behind LA, you are looking at a pleural effusion, not the pericardial effusion.
Yeah. So I'll take the next question. It's from Dr. Anshuman. He asks, in a patient on invasive ventilation, IVC seems always dilated in such scenarios. How to decide about the fluid therapy? So there are two parameters when we decide fluids in the ICU. One is a static parameter, one is a dynamic parameter. If we say IVC, we are not able to assess on a ventilated patient. Yes, there is some way, there is a distensibility index, but what is more appropriate, more apt, if the patient has got an arterial line, we look for a pulse pressure variation or stroke volume variation. So if on an arterial pressure waveform, we find differences in upstrokes, then we will say, yes, this patient is short on fluids. So that is called a pulse pressure variation. Most of the modern monitors give you a value of pulse pressure variation. So any patient having a pulse pressure variation more than 18, that means this patient needs fluids. Any patient having a value less than this, that means this patient is full on fluids. You don't need to give any more fluids. You go on to more advanced monitoring, which means PICO or EV1000, you will get a stroke volume variation, where again, stroke volume variation more than 13%, means the patient is short on fluids and you have to give more fluids. So sicker the patient, more invasive you will be when you are doing these monitorings. Okay, so next question is from Dr. Altaf. He asked diastolic function in AF and merging EA waves.
So that's exactly what we have already discussed. that you have to be entirely dependent upon the distillation time and IVRT and some velocity propagation, and don't be dependent upon the rations of E and A, because you are lost. Because if it is a pulmonary vein A wave velocity, so once A wave is lost, there are a lot of parameters that you can't trust. But what you can trust is and of course, take an average of E to E prime. Take average of 10 beats of E and take 10 beats of E prime, and then try to make some sense of it.
So next question is from Dr. Paula. He asks, what's the most specific sign to cardiac tamponade and what is the most sensitive?
So I'll tell you what the books say, and then I will tell you what you should do. Sensitivity means that you will pick up everybody, but you may over-diagnose in few. Specificity means that in whoever you have made a diagnosis, that person has got a tamponade, but you might miss a few. So if you look at the collapsibility, then there is something known as an RA collapse. So if RA collapse is seen, it's a very, very sensitive sign. And if there is an RV diastolic collapse, then it is a very specific sign. But these are things which are mentioned in the books. And best is if you can find RA and RV collapse both. Once you have this, then these are the patients who are truthfully in your so-called cardiac tamponade. So these are imaging issues. But what you can do is that you can look at the, like he said, the Doppler parameters. If your Doppler parameters are showing a variability more than 40% for the right-sided valves and more than 25% for the left-sided valve, again, it's a very sensitive sign.
So next question is, how do you assess the prosthetic wall dysfunction or clot in emergency situations in ICU?
So the first sign is clinical. The moment you find that there is a shortness of breath, all you have to do is take the gradients. If for a mitral, you are getting a gradients more than 10, if for an aortic, you are getting gradients more than 30 mean, start suspecting stuck valve. Now, these stuck valves have to be seen very carefully. And in case you're not able to make a diagnosis on transthoracic, don't hesitate to do a esophageal echo. But this index of suspicion is entirely dependent upon your clinical signs and, of course, the Dopplers. Dopplers are very important to pick up the first point of interrogation.
Next question is there any difference about how do you measure about LV function and dimensions for athletes?
So athletes will have a diastolic dysfunction. LV will have a dilated LV, and that's the reason for an LV to be 5.8 in an athlete. I don't really bother about it, but there are no set parameters because the normalcy has not been defined for athletes. But yes, dilated LV, LV and dilated LA are a feature which are a usual feature for, because it's a high output failure kind of a situation. Something like what you would get in anemia, beriberi, or pregnancy or lactation. And this is a high output issue where the compensation of LV is first and foremost in the form of dilatation.
The next question is from Dr. Prasad. He asked, circulating EF is more accurate by visual or by calculations?
So it totally depends that how accomplished echocardiographer are you. Because it's so difficult to make an assessment whether it is 30% or 40% in the initial stages of your echocardiographer. For an initiate, I would still say that they should be doing the parameters like Simpsons or whatever. But a better way is that in case somebody has got a 3D, best is to go in for a 3D and look at the ejection fraction and volumes. That is a very, very beautiful way and a very easy way to calculate ejection fraction. But yes, all of us entirely depend on visual estimations. No denial on that.
Next question is from
the problem with visual is that there can be so much of inter-observer and inter-observer variability.
Next question is from Dr. Anshuman. He asks, how to proceed for prognostication in case of isolated RV dysfunction in ICU with no etiology known, or for RV dysfunction?
RV dysfunction in itself is a poor prognostic indicator. It is a poor prognostic indicator regardless of what the etiology is. But if you know the etiology, better it is. But several times you'll not be able to find out the etiology, whether it is a right-sided cardiomyopathy, whether it is Ulz anomaly, whether it is pulmonary embolism. But yes, in case RV pressures are up, RV is dilated. And unfortunately, what happens is that with more and more of RV dysfunction, your assessment of the RV pressures become poor. Because once they are not able to generate the pressure, your TR jet velocities start falling. And that's the reason why. It's a poor prognostic indicator in itself.
So the next question is from Dr. Radhika. She asks, how to get transthoracic echo views in an ICU when the patient is on ventilator since the patient positioning is not good?
So that's what exactly I told when I was showing the echo study which we did for unexplained hypotension. Fortunately for you, you have one view which is good as against people who are post-operative for chest. That is subcostal. Subcostal view is a view. That's the reason in FATE, if you look at it, the first view they ask you to make is the subcostal view. Start learning that, but in case you're not able to get it, please don't hesitate. You must go and start doing your transesophageal echoes rather than entirely depend on transthoracic. Transthoracic has its own limitation. And the biggest limitation is that in intensive care setting, you can't turn the patient, the lights are very bright. Several times they'll be having chest tubes just in case you have put in a tube for pericardial effusion or pleural effusion or for whatever reason. And these are the reason why it's a limitation. In case you want to combat that limitation, shamelessly get into transesophageal echo mode.
So next question is from Dr. Keshav. He asks, when the patient comes with severe heart failure symptoms, how can we say it is because of diastolic heart failure?
So if your ejection fraction is fine, your E to E prime is high, your E wave is high, and your NT-proBNPs are high. Understand that we are not looking at echo to make all the diagnosis. It is unfair for people to make histopathological diagnosis or otherwise by an echo. Here, you want to find out if there is no systolic dysfunction. If there is no systolic dysfunction, you may assume that there is a diastolic dysfunction, but you have to prove it by increased cardiac enzymes like NT-proBNP. So in case your NT-proBNP is high, first and foremost is you have to stabilize the patient. Once having stabilized the patient, you can keep taking your time to calculate diastolic parameters. But these diastolic parameters, I 100% agree with you, they are not sine qua non in all the cases. And that is the time when you may need other helpful modalities. And I would be happy to get, in fact, all my shortness of breath, NT-proBNP is a must, regardless of what the echo parameters show. You would be surprised many a times that you will get all the parameters of diastolic dysfunction being normal, yet NT-proBNPs would be high, which could be because of several features. It could be because of renal failure. It could be because of septicemia. But that besides, there'll be few subsets where you would be fooled just because your echoes were fine. You didn't make a diagnosis of diastolic dysfunction. But don't be hesitant to use cardiac biomarkers.
So next question is from Dr. Rahul. He asks, how to measure IVRT?
IVRT? Let me just share my slides once again. And then I think what I'll do is carry on the other question because it takes a little while for these to share.
Yeah, just a second, sir. So the next question is, quick tip in ICU to diagnose constrictive effusion and RCM.
So let's look at the pathophysiology of what is constrictive pericarditis, and quick tip to look at what is restrictive cardiomyopathy? What is constrictive pericarditis? Constrictive pericarditis is that heart is covered in an envelope. This envelope gets thickened, and this envelope covers all the sides of the heart. So when it starts to expand, initially there is no restriction. But the moment it crosses its threshold, the envelope's thickness starts preventing its expansion. So when it comes, let me just, are my slides being shared?
Yes, yes.
So let me just come to the diastolic dysfunction, then I'll come to this. So this is what is IVRT. So you have your isovolumic relaxation time where the P wave finishes. All you have to do is just measure it from there and you'll have isovolumic relaxation time before the E wave starts. So this is what it is, and rest I can discuss offline with him. But to come to this very important question about in diastolic dysfunction, what in constrictive pericarditis, what we are seeing is that there is a relaxation, and then there is a sudden caging, which happens because of thickened pericardium. So when there is a sudden caging, where will the caging help, or where will the caging stop the expansion? Anteriorly, because it is covered by pericardium anteriorly, laterally, because it is covered by pericardium laterally, inferiorly, posteriorly. But the only place in an LV where there is no covering of pericardium is interventricular septum. So it expands, and suddenly there is a caging. All the areas get caged except interventricular septum, which flutters. So if you are getting interventricular septal bounce, this is one sign. Number two, I'm just talking about things which are of practical importance. Do a tissue Doppler. Normally what happens is that the tissue Dopplers at the medial annulus is lesser than the lateral annulus. But in a constrictive pericarditis, there is expansion. There is a caging. And where is the caging as compared to medial and lateral? It is more in the lateral, less in the medial. So paradoxically, the medial annulus velocities are higher. When medial annulus velocities are higher, lateral are lesser. This means that there is a constriction because of which the comparative medial velocities are higher. Third thing, you look at the peristaltic lung axis, you put in an M mode, expansion. One is interventricular septal bounce, we have already seen. But what about the posterior wall? Suddenly it will flatten. So these are all things which are there in constrictive pericarditis. Now come to restrictive cardiomyopathy. What is the problem in restrictive cardiomyopathy? In constrictive cardiomyopathy, the initial expansion of the LV is unhampered. It is only in the latter part of the diastole that constriction manifests because of the thickened pericardium. In restrictive cardiomyopathy, what happens? It is the muscle disorder. And this muscle disorder means that there is an expansion problem right from the word go. There is no initial unhampered issues like constrictive pericarditis. From start of the word diastole, there is a problem. So you have to see where are we heading for. Increase there is an LVDP which is high. If you're not finding signs of constriction, rest assured what you're dealing with is a restrictive cardiomyopathy. There are several other small fine print comparisons. You can calculate the ratio of pulmonary artery pressures. You can calculate, there's several, but to sum in substance is that in case you find an annulus paradox, then it is constrictive if you don't start hunting for restrictive cardiomyopathy.
So next question is from Archana. She asks, in comorbid condition like diabetes, hypertension, despite no RWMA, can we assess underlying CAD?
So yes, you can, but all you have to do is you have to make the person go on a stress echo rather than resting. Resting echo has its own problems, because when you come to diabetes especially, there could be a segmental wall motion abnormality because of cardiomyopathy. Hypertensions usually go into hypertensive failures and they can have wall motion abnormality. But in case you want to be sure, not sure, but in case you want to have some suggestion that there is an underlying significant coronary artery disease, best is to subject the patient for a stress echo. In COVID times, I would suggest that subject your patients to dobutamine stress echo and not a treadmill or a physiological stress echo, because there is more of aerosolization once the patient is on treadmill. In dobutamine stress echo, there is less of aerosolization. Turn the patient on his left side, cover himself, cover yourself up, have some sheets to cover, and then you can do a dobutamine stress echo.
So next question is, how often do you use peak PR to assess PAH if you do not have a good TR jet?
Yeah, you can. If you're getting a pulmonary regurgitation, you can calculate mean pulmonary artery pressures, which is a better way to calculate. These days, people calculate only mean pulmonary artery pressures of greater than 25, and pulmonary regurgitation is a good modality. In fact, end diastolic velocities of the pulmonary regurgitation jet are very, very reproducible, and they are very predictable.
So next question is there any specific advice for echo in COVID-19 patients?
Okay, so we have written some recommendations because more than the patient, it is for safety of you and your own staff. If there is a COVID positive patient, then you have to, if you can. So for COVID positive patients, I would suggest that you should have a separate room and separate established COVID positive patients. PPs for yourself and your technician, and you have to have a dedicated machine, or the probe at least should be a dedicated probe, which is difficult, very difficult, because it adds on to your cost. Second is, if it is a COVID suspect, in COVID suspect, you have to have, if there is chances of aerosolization are high, then you have to be wearing a level 2 prevention, which means that everybody is a COVID suspect these days, especially in Delhi. Everybody is a COVID. You just can't say everybody is a COVID suspect. So you have to have a face shield, you have to have a cap, you have to have a mask, you have to, double mask is necessary. The patient needs to be on a double mask. You have to have a sheet in between, and you must have your own echo machines with a plastic sheet so that you don't dirty them. And every time the patient goes out, you must sanitize the sheet. You have to sanitize the transparent curtain, and you have to change your own level 2 gears, which are your surgical gown, your gloves, your mask, your this thing. These are very tough times. These are very tough times. And whatever precaution you can take for yourself and for your technicians will be an understatement. Actually, more precautions you take, better it is, even if it be a step forward. It should not be a step lesser. That is the bottom line.
Ranjit, is there any time?
There is no time limit. I would leave it to your convenience, both of you.
Nitin, she is a very sharp girl. Tumhare mere kandhe pe isne banduk rakh diye, and now she says that shoot whatever way you want.
Okay, carry on for 10 more minutes. So next question is, what are the criteria you use for determining cardiac tamponade by echo?
Cardiac tamponade?
By echo. What are the criteria you use?
So whatever are the criteria for constrictive pericarditis, except for the annulus and the septal bounds, the same criteria are there for tamponade. However, if you see effusion, then those. So what are the criteria? The Doppler criteria is that for right-sided this thing. Okay, so let me just share a few more, because this is now getting a little interesting in the sense that people are more and more interested in this thing. Let me just pick out my slides if I can, and then we'll take it. But for all practical purposes, let me see if I can dig my slides immediately. You know, she was commenting that you have a very cluttered this thing, and I said I keep it cluttered because I can very easily take it off. So right-sided valves, if the velocity changes are greater than 40%, left-sided valves, if the velocities are lesser, more than 25%, these are signs that look for tamponade or for constriction. Okay, let me just see, where am I? So you have to have effusion. If you have effusion, then only you are thinking in terms of so-called Nipton. Yeah, so this is there. So only if you have effusion, then you are looking at something which is to be dealt with as tamponade. If you don't have effusion, then you have no business to think in terms of effusion. So first and foremost criteria is have an effusion. So once you have an effusion, you have to rule out tamponade, and then you look at the 2D. In 2D, if you have diastolic collapse of RA or RV or both, that becomes a reason for you to... I picked out my slides, and let me just...
Yeah. So, shall I ask the next question? Yeah. We wait for the slides.
Yeah, carry on. The slides are going to take a little bit.
One question, which is, I think, addressed to me. Is there any difference in using IV cannula and arterial sheath in measuring invasive blood pressures? So, IV cannula, basically, I think you mean to say the Velcro cannula. See, difference is only in terms of how long it lasts. So Velcro usually lasts for a lesser time. I would say 48 hours, maybe maximum. Invasive sheaths, they last for a longer duration of time. If your patient is sick, we always prefer to put a sheath rather than with a Velcro. Post-op patients, intra-op, some anesthesia, people usually prefer to put a Velcro. Next question is SVC of any use for volume assessment?
SVC for volume assessment?
Yeah.
So you can, just in case you are unable to sort out with this thing. The only problem is that, okay. So SVC can be used. Actually, you use it every day. Why do you want to use SVC when you can look at the JVP? What is jugular venous pressure? Jugular venous pressure is continuation of superior vena cava. And superior vena cava and JVP are markers of right ventricular and diastolic pressure. So if you are looking at JVP, so it is easily approachable by an echo to look at IVC rather than SVC. But if you want to see SVC, why? I've got no problem. Actually, that's what you do on a clinical basis all the time.
Yeah. So as I said, SVC is actually a static parameter when we are assessing, like central venous pressures, superior vena cava, when you are seeing on the ultrasound. These are static parameters. And when you try to see the IVC or the stroke volume variation, those are dynamic parameters. Dynamic parameters are known to be much more accurate for volume assessment as compared to static. The conventional teaching is that we measure the CVP, but now we are moving to be more accurate to the dynamic parameters, which includes stroke volume variation. Okay, so the next question is there any term called impending pericardial tamponade? And if yes, how can we differentiate with real pericardial tamponade?
So actually, these are imaginary terms in the sense that if several times there is a dichotomy, your echo diastolic parameters may not translate into a clinical tamponade. Because for clinical tamponade to happen, you have to have pulsus paradoxes. And this pulsus paradoxes is something which kind of not seen many a times. Though there may be a Doppler paradoxes. So these are impending parameters where you are not waiting for the clinical parameters to happen, like pulsus paradoxes or falling blood pressure or falling urine output. It is better to intervene once you find that there is a diastolic parameter, tamponade, which is there on the echo, you must intervene quick.
Okay, so the next question is, what are the reliable position tips of ultrasound probe for scanning of lungs to diagnose pulmonary edema? I'll take that question.
Okay.
So you usually use the transverse probe, which is the highest frequency probe of 10 megahertz. And you usually try to place the probe vertically. That means you when you visualize it, you visualize the two ribs, and in between you try to see the lung window. And in the lung window, if you see torch lights, if I can share my screen, I would show you how it looks like. But I think let Dr. Sameer do the screen sharing first.
No, you do it. I'm okay. If you want, I can. I have.
Please start. I'll do it later.
Okay. So this is the cardiac tamponade slides that I just want to. Are you okay? You can see them.
Yeah. Yes. Yes, sir.
So these are the slides in which I just wanted to show you that this is a normal inflow. Mitral inflow is normal, where there is hardly any variation. But the moment there is a tamponade, there is a fall of the peaks. And this fall of the peak, if it is greater than 25% for mitral, it is bad. Now, these are certain examples. I will not go into it, but Nitin,
yes, sir.
When automatic things become autonomous, this is the problem you face. So these are the issues that you can sort out. So if there is a diastolic collapse of RA and or RV, you are looking at a tamponade, provided you are able to see pericardial effusion. There are certain fallacies, like I said, that in a pleural effusion, you can be misguided. But again, the cutoff is, if it is posterior to LA, then it is pleural effusion. If it is anterior to LA, then you are fine. You are looking at a pericardial effusion. In RV, increased RV pressures, the tamponade can be missed. Like in RV infarction, the tamponade can be missed, and which can be a little serious issue. Think IVC plethora with blunted response, which can be because of RVDP increased, which can be because of tamponade, which could be because of constrictive pericarditis. Now, how you go about it is that if you are seeing pericardial effusion, then you are looking at tamponade and also, of course, the Doppler trace. So I'll finish off here. You continue to share your screen, and then in case needed, I'll come back again.
Yeah, I'll just take the last question. Have you seen any myocarditis in COVID patient, and what is the percentage?
So almost everybody who dies, he dies with a myocarditis. It is so sad that we can't do anything, because I wish science knew more. But unfortunately, the bias is that whatever COVID patients we are getting, we are looking after our own COVID patients who are dying, who have been hypertensive or coronary artery disease. And when you look at them, you lose them most of the times because of either arrhythmias, or you lose them because of myocarditis. Very high, sir. Very high. Yes. This is my personal experience from our own hospital.
So thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Sameer. I think we have just finished with the questions. Most of them people are asking for recording. I just hand over to the Philips team now to take over.
Thank you so much, sir. I think it was a very, very pertinent session, and I wish we had done this a little earlier. But, if Dr. Nitin and Dr. Sameer can collaborate sometime later as well to take it to the next step, there are requests already for that. And I would like to assure participants that after Dr. Nitin and Dr. Sameer approves the recording and they allow us to share, we will be very happy to share with you all. On that note, thank you for sticking us for this long. It's been a really long, but a very, very insightful session. Thank you, Dr. Nitin. Thank you, Dr. Samir. Dr. Samir, over to you for any final comments.
Thank you very much, and thanks for to everybody for tolerating me. Nitin is a very dear friend, and thank you for getting me to be in touch with him. And have a lovely Sunday, whatever is left of it. And Sat Sri Akal.
Sat Sri Akal, sir. Thank you so much. So we usually never promote our products, but because it is COVID times, you know, Philips has very recently launched a product called Lumify. And it has got one probe which actually helps you scan, you know, all possible lung imaging, cardiac imaging requirements to be specific. You can reach out to me or to your Philips rep to know more, because this is a very, very cost-effective system that we've launched. It can connect to a simple phone or an iPad or any other device. And we thought it's important that we come out with you know, cheaper, cost-effective solutions in this time, because the need for imaging is very high. Also, we have a very smart, you know, support mechanism around the finances, so that it doesn't put pressure on your practice. I do not normally talk about products, but I think it is also the need of ours. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.